can see right here, I've got essentially my workspace. I predominantly work out of the workspace in my own home. I actually just spent a lot of time building a really, really awesome workshop. So, big table, lots of space, gets it kind of high so you're not sitting down low. Really, really important. A lot of things to kind of keep track of when you're doing this is that you got to have all your tools. You've got to have them there. You've got to have them ready. You really need to make sure that you don't have to go back out to the store after you've already started getting ready to put your figures together. There's a lot of specialty tools out there. I can talk about them a little bit. I may even use a little bit of them just so I can kind of give you an idea of the certain kinds of things that you really should be looking to use. But more often than not, what I'm going to do is I'm going to be using product that you can purchase at the game box in Topsom. And you can walk in and you can say, hey, I saw Graydon on stream and, you know, he told me about these tools and I'd like to know how much they are and if I can get a hold of them. Cool stuff. Really get into it. So I'm going to start with reaching by my camera because I really didn't place this well. This back. This is your generic hobby knife. Actually, it's not. This is a Citadel hobby knife. This nice, really nice knife. Locks into place. Really, really solid blade. You need to have a good sharp knife. Not having a good sharp knife is kind of the absolute worst thing in the world to deal with. You will cut yourself all day long on a dull blade. You will just shred your fingers. It's absolute crap. Sucks. The next things that you're going to want to have on hand, and these are things that I'm going to probably do a little bit on one figure that I have working on today, is it's called pinning. So this is a pin drill. Again, another Citadel product that we sell at the shop. Now, a reminder, these Citadel products, they're really, really great. They're just kind of a little expensive. The Citadel Hobby Knife is like $25. Same thing with the pin drill set. The snips I'm going to show you, and also the flash remover tool, hence the beginning video, flash, which is the most important part of this process. But, so what I'm showing you basically right now is this pin kit, okay, is going to come with a bunch of really tiny little, I don't know what the hell he's talking about, the start above. Let's turn him down a little bit. So these pins are here, and the one that you're going to use is usually the smallest frickin' one you can find. These are here are going to be the most important thing to making sure that these small arms and legs and little bits on your figure don't fall off when your figure has the unplanned impact, mishap, drop. Your stuff's going to break. And this helps prevent breakage. So we got that. The next thing we got, no, we'll go to that next. Oops, shit. Okay. We've got our pinning material. A lot of people use paper clips. There are some people that also use brass rod that comes in pinning kits specifically for miniatures. Those are great. The paper clips are kind of suck. They'll chew up your stuff as far as like cutting them up all the time. The brass rod's really good. It's a soft metal, obviously, so it's not gonna ruin like your snips or anything like that. This stuff right here, okay, this is floral wire. All right, I buy this stuff for $2, or you know, I buy this stuff once every 15 years for $2. There's a ton on this roll. It's a 22 gauge quarter pound roll of floral wire. The reason why I use floral wire is the only thing that you care about in pinning is getting contact through the figure. Okay, it's not there to make it like a, you know, you're adding bones to a body, which you kind of are, but it's not really what the whole point is. The point is to make sure that if you have a potential break or bend, it's not two flush pieces of figure together. It's two pieces of figure and a crossbar or a tube, something like that, to help strengthen that joint. So this stuff right here, the reason why I use this is the fact that it's flexible. Okay, and you can cut it really easy. You can cut this stuff practically with a pair of scissors. So if you don't got a lot of money to throw at the hobby yet and you're just kind of getting into it, the real shining stars that you really, really need to get is the hobby knife, a pin drill, and this floral wire, which is amazing. The next thing we're going to talk about is a pair of snips. Snip, snip. Am I showing it right? Cool, snip, snip. These are Citadel snips. I got a lot of Citadel stuff. I work in a game store. I get a lot of stuff. These ones right here, they're running about $30. They have a really nice flush kind of surface. So that way when you're cutting things off of plastic sprue and things like that, you can take off as much plastic as humanly possible. So that way the cleanup job afterwards, which is what we're going to be dealing with for the most part today, is a lot easier. So that's a great thing. The final piece of this tool showcase is what's called a flash tool. It's made by Citadel. Again, expensive piece, really good. I've had amazing results with this flash tool. I did not think that I was going to use this at all until I started using it. And the fact that this is a hardened steel edge, okay, so it's going to keep its edge. It has a varied curve, so that way when you have your kind of strange, like, work around, like, shoulders and shoulder pads and, like, the back's legs and stuff like that, it can get into those, it can contour properly with that while taking the mold line off while I'm not doing really crazy stuff in the model. So, these are the bag of tools, the stuff that I like to use. So, with that in mind, we have these prepared. We're ready. It's awesome. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to actually get into some figures and we're going to clean them up. And then if time permits, I'm going to try to base one of them. What I'm going to do... Kaya the Wildheart. This is a circle caster. This is actually a brand new caster, two circle, or at least newish. I've got the 2017 cards right here. Some pretty great abilities. I'm only going to show them really quick so I don't get my ass sued. Cool. All right. Kaya the Wildheart. This has got some mold on it. Not a lot. Privateer has been doing pretty good. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to clean up the mold on this figure, and then I'm going to assemble one of mine. It's going to seem really backwards, but it'll make sense because I don't want to put together Raph's figures for him. I want him to have that experience of screaming a lot. So this is a multi-part kit. This is a combination of resin, or a plastic-style resin, and white metal, or pewter, depending on who you talk to. There's a lot going on with this figure, and... I wonder if he'll let me put it together. Let's find out, shall we? Let's wonder if he's actually going to answer his phone inside the house. He's currently playing Overwatch on the PC because he's that kind of girl. Hey.
Hello?
Hey. Hi. So, I'm doing the video right now of flashing and assembling a figure. Okay. And unfortunately, the stuff that I've got looks really good.
Okay. Look,
it doesn't have any flashing on or anything like that. Can I grab one of your figures and put it together?
Yeah, sure.
All right. I'm grabbing Kaya the Wildheart. Is that cool?
Yeah, sure.
All right, do you want me to cork it and everything like that?
If you want to.
All right, I will.
All
right. All right,
bye.
All right, so we're going to look at this figure. We've got a great big chunk right here. This is obviously not part of his tail. We've got this great big stem here. Unless he's some sort of Matrix embryo dog, this is not going to happen that way. So what we need to do is we need to do some creative cutting, and then we're probably going to need to do a little bit of dancing around the plastic to make sure we can maintain some of that fur. So I just cut that piece off. again, the high quality snips is really, really important because you get nice flush cuts. Now I'm going to take a look at this. She's pretty hairy there because of that cut. So I'm going to give myself some light. I'm going to really blind my own head. So I'm going to bring it up here. I'm going to eventually position these cameras better too. Let's see if I can't show you that. Yeah, all right. Okay, kids. Do you see that chunk right here on the end of the tail? Right. So that right there is not part of the what we would consider part of the model. That's remnants of the casting technique. We need to get rid of this stuff. So there's a couple ways to do it. If you don't own a flashing tool, which none of you are going to until you get really into this hobby, or maybe you'll buy it because you are susceptible to my wily ways, you're going to get out your hobby knife. Okay? Good stuff. And then we're going to get in here and we're basically going to be carving out what we think the fur should be looking like. So what I'm going to do first is I'm going to trim back as much of this crud as I can. Okay. Now when you do this, you want to really, really be aware of how your knife handles. This is the importance of a sharp knife. Okay. So right now I can run this knife holding it essentially like this in my hand, all right? You seeing that? You on that? Cool. Okay, so the whole point of doing it like this is the fact that I have massive amounts of control of this knife. If this was a dull knife, I would essentially be trying to scrape pieces of plastic off of this figure, or metal. And that's how you get a slip, and that's how you get a cut. So really, again, the safest knife is the sharpest knife. If you feel like your X-Acto blade is getting really kind of, you know, dull, you're having a hard time pressing through easy plastics and stuff like that, just replace your blade. The blades are really, really cheap. So we've got that tail portion fixed there. Still a little chunky. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to scrape using the edge of the knife blade really, really gently. Okay? It's kind of like you're sanding it, but you're just essentially peeling off the rough layers of that tail. Then we're going to tackle his umbilical cord here. So stuff like this, you've got a really, really big piece of plastic. Your first instinct is to just grab a hold of it and break it. Don't do that. You're going to get, it's going to be even bigger mess to clean up afterwards. So doing a series of small pinching cuts, we are going to get into that figure and try to keep the contour of the body that's there. Now we're starting to get... All right, that sucked. All right. So now we've got that off of there. And you can see... I can get that up in there. All right. All right, you see that? There's the umbilical. And right here. This right here. Okay. You may not see it very well. Oh, there it is right there. That does not look right. That does not look like how a belly should. A belly shouldn't have some sort of weird looking stone thing coming out of the bottom of it. So we're going to take our hobby knife and as carefully as possible, we're going to trim some of this back and we're going to try to make it so it's flush with the belly. Now, when I say flush, that's a little misleading. I mean, you want to have it so it's contoured with the place where it's supposed to be. So what you're doing is you're carving, okay? Just a little bit. You're not like trying to become the next Michelangelo. You're just basically trying to get it so that way it doesn't look like you didn't make some effort on cleaning up that area there. So he's been flashed. We're going to check the other pieces. All right. Let's look at his leg there. Don't really got anything bad going on there. That's going to be fun to put on. We've got this set of legs that are connected. We've got these nubs here. So I'm going to get rid of these later on. I'll show you what I mean by that. This is how we're going to be talking about pinning. If it needs to be pinned. Sometimes figures don't need to be pinned. But this may need to be because it looks like this is a pretty major contact point. Ooh, all right. So here we go. We've got what looks like Kaya's arm. Okay, look at that. Nice big old piece of flash. Isn't that sexy? Okay, and this camera is not focusing very well. So, boink. Here she comes. Yeah, we're going to look for mold lines, because a piece that big sometimes means there's going to be a mold line, and we don't have any. That's good. Really safe. All right. Weapons like this. Again, this is an arm. Believe it or not, this is a little arm. These are the nightmares that keep a modeler up all night. Got another big piece of flash right there. Oh, we got a little bit of something here. We can play with that. Oh, man. That's terrible. They got a mold line right down the middle of her face. Why do they cast down the middle of her face? All right. Okay, so faces are a dangerous thing to have to fix, because if you screw up, you don't have a face anymore. All right, so see if I can get you in there. Okay, so you're not going to see it very well, because I got a lot. Oh, maybe. There's a big furry burr underneath there. We're going to take care of that. That big furry burr. Okay. So with these lanky figures, especially female figures, because for some reason these sculptors really, really want to work with the female form and make it be as lanky and slinky as humanly possible. And the most form-fitting protective armor on the market. Alright, we're getting there. We got a body, we got a booty. The booty looks good, the legs look good, shoulders look good. Man, this figure's not that bad. Just had big pieces of chunky flesh. This is going to be mostly like, all right, we've got a winner chicken dinner. This is a perfect example of flash lines. So this right here is a seam. This right here is a casting mold line. What I'm talking about is that line right there. It's in the middle of the bottom side of that cloak. Doesn't that look terrible? Doesn't that look like garbage? So I'm going to pull out the Citadel tool. Because it's the last piece I have to flash on this figure, so I might as well have some fun. So, the benefit of the Citadel tool, like I said, again, is the fact that it has a curve to it. So you can see you've got this curve that we're working with in the inside here. So this will help stay to that contour, okay? You're using that hard edge. You're essentially scraping it like you would, Whitland, getting down south with Dixie or something like that. You'll notice in the white metal figures, it's going to burnish it a little bit. Not a big deal. You're going to prime this thing anyway, so it's not, you're never going to see that burnishing. So you're going to shave into this. You're going to kind of bring it down a little bit. You want to make it so it kind of matches up. You know, just work your tool, work your knife, just make it look a lot better than it just did. So with that, good. Yeah, that's good enough. Looks good. Okay, cool. So, we've got Kaya the Wildheart flashed and prepped. So, the figure portion of this is there. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to deal with the base. So, my first rule now, as I am going forward in the world as a new, brand new man, is that all your bases must be textured. And by textured, I mean they must have something dynamic going on with them. There must be some sort of terrain. There must be some sort of growth. It needs to have some environments, life. Because if they don't, you are going to have a little plastic man standing on a little black disc forever. And it will look out of place on a tabletop, on your make-believe or battlefield, and it will suck. It's just not cool. We don't do that. So we're going to talk about, real quick, basing stuff. So we're going to get into the glues that we're going to use. So what I use now for basing and everything like that, I use Zap-A-Gap. We just got this stuff back into the shop. It comes in numerous bottle sizes. This size, $6, $7, $8 a bottle. It'd be the last glue you use. All right, the next thing that we are going to talk about is how do we get the base to be beautifully textured? So there is my second favorite store in the world is Joann Fabrics. So we're talking about you guys in Topsom, because that's where I am. So we're going to talk about Joann Fabrics. Joann Fabrics is for everyone, just in case you're wondering. I go in there more than my wife and my mother-in-law combined. My wife barely goes in there. My mother-in-law is a sewer. I'm in there probably 3 to 4 times a week. It's an addiction. It's sad. But you get cool stuff. Really, really cool stuff. So I'm going to hold this up in front of my face. Boom. Then I'm going to put it in front of the camera. Boom. So this is sheets of cork. All right. Cork is one of the best modeling surfaces that you can work with right now as a tabletop board gamer. It's really cheap. You can get 4 sheets of this quarter inch cork, which you can quarter inch and eighth inch. A buddy of mine likes to use eighth inch. I use quarter inch just because it brings a little bit of lift the figure. But at any rate, it's like $8. Really cheap. So there are a million and one ways to apply cork to your base. So how do we get this on here? How do we make this make sense? Well, there's a lot of things you can do. You can grab the base, and you can grab a Sharpie, and you can trace out a circle. I hate this method, but I'm going to show it to you anyway, because I just hate it. Here's the problem with this method, is the fact that the circle you trace out is for the... my head's in the way. Bad head. The circle you trace out fits the exterior of the base. It doesn't fit this magical little center area. Okay? That's the area where you're actually putting your texture. This outside right here is where you're going to put like some marks to designate where its shoulders are so you can see its front facings and stuff like that. And generally we try to leave these black, or we put like color on one edge to signify a unit or to signify a spacing. We don't put terrain on the outside edge of this. It looks ridiculous. So you can trace this, and you can try to trim it back. It is a method. I do not do that. This is what I do. So I grab the cork, I grab this, okay? And then I literally take and press into it and tear just like this. Oh no, it's not even, Graydon. It's gonna look like crap. That's fine. I don't want it to be even. So it's sitting like this. You could technically use it like this. You could have like... you could put some more stuff on this if you're not really familiar with like all the other things that I could talk about for basing, which we'll get into like a massive basing tutorial at some point. We're talking about getting your figure flashed and on the base today. But this isn't what we care about. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our Zappa Gap Glue woohoo guy. Make sure it's not plugged up, and we are going to slurm this all over that bad boy. Now, the one bad thing about this glue is that it bonds to everything, including your fingers and your skin and your face and your hair and your teeth. I got it on my teeth once. That was really, really bad. All right, so we got it on there. We pushed into it. Cool. Then we're going to try to clean this up a little bit. So we want to try to get this so it feels like it's coming out of that center of that base. Just take the corner, the edge of your thumb, and just roll it down. Just roll it down. Roll it around town. Oh no, that seems like that's going to really hang a little more than I want it to. Use your fingernail. Roll it right down. Just freaking drive that right in. Oh yeah, it feels good. Oh yeah. Okay, cool. We're getting there. Yeah, let's get the... Woo! Come on, baby. All right, cool. Done. Cool. Let that dry. Take your leavings. Now, you can save this stuff right here. You can use this to texture more onto your base. Like, actually, right now, I could take this piece right here, and I could glue it right here, and I could be like, cool, she has a riser area. Let's do that. This is the best part of this, is the fact that can be all the creative you want. And for some of the stuff, people will tell you to use white glue or as we know it here in the North, Elmer's glue. That's why. I don't care. It's fine. So we got the base. I feel like it's missing something. More texture. So there are some other products out there in the market. Oh, I'm leaning away. Oh, I'm leaning back in. Okay. Citadel makes, and this will make you infuriated, okay? Citadel makes sand. I'm going to charge you for going outside with a dustbin and probably a paper cup. I'm going to charge you, I hope you're ready for this, $13 for a box of sand, and I'm going to tell you to buy it. And the reason behind that is this, okay? I'll open this bad boy up. It's clean. It doesn't have, like, cigarette butts and stuff like that in it. It doesn't have, you know, potentially vermin, ants. So this is the Citadel sand, okay? It's really good. It's not as fine as I probably would want it to be. But we have ways around that, and we'll do that in another video. But we're gonna use this stuff right now because we're lazy. So now with the Citadel sand, we're gonna take the same glue, and we are going to directly, not over the sand. We're gonna just make a pattern with it, okay? Just like this. We're gonna like some stuff out from the rock, a little bit of a swoosh there. A little bit in the corner of the rock. We're going to get some sand in the edges of that. Cool. Awesome. So there are numerous ways to attach this sand to this rock. So creative. And boom. That is so much more textured. That has so much more life to it. You are going to enjoy putting something on this because it will look like they're traveling through a rocky place. So bringing this up to the light, look at that. Isn't that great? Simple. Just like seconds. Wargamers have not been doing this for decades. Don't be like us. Be the new generation. Texture your bases. All right, so Kaya the Wildheart. We're going to talk about the build-out. We're going to worry about how she's going to go together. So we do a lot of dry fitting to start. Dry fitting is really important because you'll know if your pieces are miscast or out of sync. So we're going to look at first these lower legs in the body. They obviously connect right here. Okay. We've got a large indentation right there on both ends and a small plug to go in that hole. Now this gives me concern because the fact that I don't have a lot of contact point for glue, like right here. I have a thin rim right there for the glue. I don't like that. So we are going to pin the legs. No, we're not. Yeah, we'll pin the legs. Okay. So what I'm going to do is these nubs, I'm going to cut those right off. Take my hobby pliers or any hobby pliers you can find. I keep around a set of files for this exact moment. File. Try to get that down a little bit. My goal is to have a flat surface that I will then pilot a hole for and then drill into. And then I will drill into the other side of the figure, and I will have this piece of rod, and it will be great. And I think I really only need to do that one side. Cool. So we've shaved down this point. All right. So what you do now is you take your hobby knife, okay? And let me find a good angle. You take your hobby knife. You know, press in the center of that. Press into the center of that and make it an indentation, a dimple. Okay, just press in, turn a little bit. Don't do it too much, especially in the white metals, because you can actually break off the tip of your knife and then you have to fish it out, and that's really not fun. So we've got that. Gonna grab our pin drill. There's my bit. Organization's a really, really important thing also on your bench. Don't be like me. All right. So we put our drill bit into our pin drill. We grab our legs. We put this into the hole that we pre-piloted with our hobby knife, and we drill. So you don't want to go too far, because you will be drilling through the figure. And I've been known to do that. I figure that up all the time. We know that this hole is going to match up here. So, using our magical eyeballs, we are going to estimate where the hole goes. You could pilot on the plastic, but this is such a flat, open space, I don't need to. So again, we're drilling right into that bad boy. I'm screwing around. You got a nice, good size hole in there. Okay, you got a hole. Cool. We're going to grab our fluoro wire. I'm going to cut off a piece. All right. Probably, you know, we're always going to start a little long. All right. Going to insert that fluoro wire into one of the holes. I'm going to start with a hole on the wolf. We're going to see that it's there. And I know this way too long. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go in. I'm going to trim that wire back just enough where that is going to make contact. Just like that. Okay, you see that little pin right there? Cool. That's going to go in the hole in the leg. So the reason why I really like the fluoro wire is that when you're in this situation and you're trying to make sure that these things match up, if you're just off a little bit, you can bend it. And you still have that stronger join, but now you don't have to be like dead on accurate. You can kind of miss a little bit. So we're going to put glue in the sockets. We're going to put glue in the socket where the pin is. We're going to be careful not to lift the pin out with the glue, which I do almost daily. And we're going to get that seat again. You bastard. There we go. Okay, cool. So with this Apigap glue, you'll find that it doesn't usually take all that long for the glue to harden. Just give it, you know, give it like 30 seconds. You know, don't screw around with it too much. Drink something. And then you should be good. Now we've got that in there. We're going to look at the next pieces. We've got a wolf leg. It's got a lot of surface contact. This is actually a lot better than I thought. So point-to-point surface contact. So we've got this area right in here. This is where our surface contact is going to be. This socket to the back end of this leg right here. So we're going to make our glue contact. We're going to fill that hole with glue, not be overzealous, because then we just basically have like this leaking glue pile. You want to be generous with your, you know, but you don't want to be too generous. All right, so those are glued, seized into place. We're going to look at now Kaya. So we've got this cloak. This cloak's got a really, really, really nice socket point. So I think we can actually not pin that. So we won't. Make our contact point. Come on, you son of a bitch. So we're going to try to attach the head here. Head's a pretty good contact point. It's in a really deep socket, so we're not going to have to worry about pinning that. This model is really, really great. So far, I haven't had to pin much. Just the legs, because I was worried about it falling. So we're going to get that head in there. We're going to hold that there for a second. We're going to contemplate the universe and our place in it. Boom. Not too much glue. If you put a lot of glue in there, it's going to run. Running glue is basically like adding mold lines to your model. It's gonna be gross. It will look like crap. You'll be upset. Your parents will disown you. So again, here's another example of, you know, good contact points, really, really solid, you know, solid seams and stuff like that. She's going to seat real well, not worried about her falling off. So boom, she's great. We're just going to take care of that. Now, the final stage, the one where all the biscuits come into play. We want her to look dynamic on the base. So I'm going to mark out where this little tab goes on this base. Oh, and it digs in. Some figures will have these little foot tabs on them. It's, you know, they're a pretty decent handhold to keep the figure in place. A lot of us that have been doing this for a really long time, we will pin the figure to the base, because we just don't want it to fall off, because it's happened to us. Alright, I gotta do a little more reaming on that hole. Things that your parents don't want to hear you say in another room. Okay, here we go. Wish me luck. Glue in the hole. So cork is porous, so you don't get a lot of time to work with it. Especially if you're gluing figures to it. So this is the figure constructed on a base. This is how you will view it from the top down in the battle top. Okay? To the tabletop. So we've got, you know, dynamic positioning here. We've got a little bit of a rock. We've got her with her arm outstretched. She's riding that wolf. You got a lot of front weight on this model, so I'm not really too worried about it being tippy. So, there we go. And that, boys and girls, is how to put the thing together. Next time that I do a figure thing, it may not be this figure because my son may hate me. But next time we will talk about priming. And it will be a much shorter video. I'm probably going to have to break this one up into a couple, but maybe not. So, thanks for watching. Again, this is Graydon with Gamebox Video Games and Comics in Topsom. Phone number there is 207-373-1136. And also with the Crooked Dice Gaming Group. And have a good night.